All right, it's been a minute. I am going to talk about spoiler-filled The Ship of Destiny. I've done it. I finished the Liveship Traders series, and I loved it. I am going to have a spoiler-free chat, but I do still have two spoiler chats. For the first book, that one was more vlog style, and the second one's more like this one, where I'm just blurting thoughts to the camera. Kind of have notes. I mostly just have character names to remind me not to forget to talk about that character's arc and how amazing it was. Everything was amazing. Perfection for me. This is definitely getting on my like mental list of I don't even care if people find objective things that are wrong and to critique. It's a perfect series. So yeah, I want to talk about all the things because it's just one of those things. And I know like this video is going to get like 80, 200 views if I'm lucky. It's fine, because not many people have read Ship of Destiny on the bookish internet. It's sad, guys. We are few. We are a few people, and it's okay, but we need to gather more so we can get illustrated editions. How cool would it be to see those dragons and serpents? I want to see Vivacia and Paragon. Like, we need that, right? Like, I want to see Bingtown. I want to see it. Anyways, that's a different thing, but we need to gather people and make it popular enough that publishers will do this. It's they're gonna skip it, guys. They're gonna skip it and go to Tawny Man, and like I'm sure Tawny Man's great, but no. But let's get into it. I've kind of split it based off portions of the book, which the book kind of did naturally itself. So we've got the Vivacia and everyone there. We've got Paragon and everyone there, and then we kind of have Malta, and then we have the dragon. Like that's kind of how the story sort of compartmentalized itself. So we're going to start in the Vivacia, and woo. So Vivacia herself has quite a personality journey, this story. So we start off with Vivacia that we have known is happy to be a pirate ship, kind of really crushing on Kennet. Her and Wintrow have kind of this disconnect. And then Wintrow, we left him in Madship. He wakes up, right? And suddenly she realizes she's not really alive. And then the dragon memories come forth and are like the primary personality. So suddenly we have Bolt instead of Vivacia. And that was so stressful. When that happened, I was just like, what? I've been buddy reading this. Well, not really. I've been blurting my thoughts to my friend Stephanie the entire time. And I'm like, I think Vivacia's dead. Maybe not dead, but Vivacia's not doing good. That was all incredibly stressful. And I didn't dislike Bolt. But I didn't like Bolt. Like, there was time where Bolt and Edda were talking, and I was like, I kind of don't mind this, but, like, I also don't like that Vivacia was supplanted. And by the end, and we do have this, like, merging of personalities, it was so great, but kind of heart-wrenching, because then Althea and Vivacia finally get that reunion, and times have changed. This year or two that they've both been apart, they're completely different. They're not, like, the parts that fit together anymore, which really makes sense in real life. Not talking about dragon ships or anything. When you spend time apart from someone who used to be a perfect fit for you in life as a friend, a partner, etc., sometimes when you come back together, sometimes it's not a perfect fit. Time changes you. It doesn't mean you can't still be important to each other, but time evolves, your needs change, and that's what happened here, just with a magical ship. Like, but still so good, because Robin Hobb is masterful, is completely masterful. And so then also on the ship, we have Edda, who decides to get pregnant based off the advice of Bolt. What a move. And I really loved that Edda ended up being the pirate queen. That's awesome. And that you kind of see the seeds of her and Wintrow. They're going to have this family together, bare minimum. They're going to raise this child together. And maybe there will be a slow romance that happens off page. And that's really exciting to me. Like, You kind of saw the slow seeds of it early, but, like, Edda was always blinded by Kennet, and Wintrow was pretty young. Like, I mean, I don't know the age gap between Edda and Wintrow. I know Edda was significantly younger than Kennet, but, you know, so I like that it didn't automatically be, like, when Kennet was removed, replace with Wintrow. I liked that. And Wintrow. So I think we get the least amount of Wintrow perspectives in this book. And I think it's been interesting. You start with Ship of Magic and you kind of think Wintrow's like your main point of view. He's one of your first ones after Kennet. It goes like Kennet, Wintrow, and then I think Althea. I could be wrong. It could be Kennet, Althea, Wintrow. It's been a minute since I've read Ship of Magic. But regardless, you get a sense that he's going to be a big player, and he is, but you get less point of views from him. And it's mostly him dealing with the guilt of, like, knowing a crime was committed by someone he valued and looked up to and not standing up for his family member. You also have his strain with what's happened to Bolt and figuring that out, but you do kind of get to see through third-party perspectives how much Wintrow has really grown from the beginning to the end, how he becomes de facto, like, the new captain pirate. Like, Etta's the queen, but Wintrow's in charge of everyone, and that's just, like, a thing that was accepted. And, like, we start the first book, he can barely do anything on a ship, right? So he definitely has more presence, more power, more agency. And I do think he doesn't lose who he was at the beginning either. He's still pretty philosophical. He's still very much connected to his ideals. And I don't think he's really lost faith in his religion. It's evolved. But it's interesting how much of Wintrow is still the same and how much has changed. But I do think he became less important as the series went on, mainly because Kennet, I think, became so much more important. When you read Ship of Magic, I don't think you think Kennet's going to become as important as he does in the way that he does. Like, in my head, I'm like, yes, he's going to be an antagonistic force by the end. We're just right now, he's not the worst force. I did not call him being a Bingtown traitor's kid. Nope. I did know that Paragon and him had a past. I guessed that. I just didn't know that they were family. And I was on Kennet's side for a long time. This is very much like, I knew he was bad, I knew he was manipulative, I knew he was morally not good, but I was like, you can pull it together. You can have a redemption arc, it is not too late. And then he assaults Athea, and I'm like, no. I was basically the wrist watch thing that he wears. I was like, you crossed a line there, sir. You crossed a line, and yeah, that was really a point of no return, and you really feel that in the story. But still, his death, like, I had to pause while reading with a friend, and I was like, I know he's about to die. I don't care that he's dying, but I need him to end up with Paragon now, because somehow in this story, I've learned that for closure, that he needs to die on Paragon. Like, that's what this world's lore needs for me to have closure. This must happen. And it did. And, like, man, Kennet is just one of the best antagonistic, villainous characters that I've ever read. Because whereas with Kyle, who does make an appearance again in this story, is just someone I just viscerally hate and find no redeeming qualities. And I'm just like, you just lean into your privilege and you treat everyone like crap and I hate you. Kennet is literally just like a product of his abuse and is contributing to the cycle of abuse. It doesn't make anything he does valid. It doesn't excuse his behaviors. It doesn't make me think that was reprehensible. Like, the chapter after that where everyone's not believing Althea, I'm just like, this chapter should have just been called gaslighting. That chapter was so infuriating. Not inaccurate, but so infuriating. It was classic Robin Hobb. And so I thought he was just more compelling because it's not like we were ever really shown that he's a fantastic person. He's charismatic. People love him. He has vision. But we've never really been shown he's a good person, per se. And that's because kind of we learn there really isn't even that much of him in him because he was brought back to life a couple times by Paragon. And, like, there's just a lot with Kennet. And I'm so glad he was in the story, even though he's a trash human being. Like, not a good person. So, yeah. And just briefly with Kyle, I am extremely happy he is dead, and Althea is a bigger person than me. Everyone in the story is a bigger person than me. And Wintrow in saving his dad, and Althea in being like, I won't tell people what really happened. You know, because literally Kyle's was like, just leave everyone behind and take me home, I'm done. And, like, sure, he was just put through not a negligible amount of torture, but, like, he didn't care about anyone in his family. He just cared about himself. Just selfish and cruel till the end. That was Kyle Haven. And also, I think you don't notice at the beginning, right? Like, at the beginning, you hear he's from this other land. And it's not till Ship of Magic that you realize, like, the men from that other land are, like, they're a lot. So, like, a lot of him makes sense based off world building. It doesn't mean I like him, though. Man, I was pretty happy that the novel removed him from the scene pretty quickly. So I think approximately that is all the craziness that happened with Vivacia. You know, she becomes this molded personality with her dragon self, and just Wintrow ends up keeping her. It was pretty great. And then we got the Paragon, my favorite little found family, with Paragon, Brashen, Althea, Clef, which we won't really talk about Clef, but I love Clef, Amber, who I have, since Madship, have had some, not my own personal revelations. I need to thank Rhea from the book Finch for really the revelations being there, because they're fantastic, and I'm pretty sure canon. I mean, I haven't looked it up on any forums or anything, so I guess if you are someone like that, but I'm pretty positive the revelations are correct. And then who else is there? Oh, I just want to mention real quick, Jack from the Six Duchies. She's fantastic. Everything she says is so funny. I didn't like that she didn't believe Althea. Like, that was, like, you know, a knock against her. But, like, the way she fights, the way she's so sexually free, the way she's so powerful because she's from a land where women aren't seen as subservient as often. Loved her. Loved her. But, yeah, so... Let's talk about Althea and Brashen and how that was the best angst thing ever. And I'm so glad that we had that will they, won't they tension. And like in the midst of that, the mutiny that happens with the first mate Lavoie, which was so stressful, especially as like Lavoie's courting Paragon. And we're still at the point in the story that like even Paragon doesn't know what side he's on. He finally gets to a point. There's a lot of growth for Paragon and he has a lot to handle because his mental health will never be 100%. It's definitely something he will be managing. He's definitely like more whole by the end of the story, and we learn about a lot about why he is the way he is, and I freaking love that Amber made him look like Fitz. I'm pretty sure that's what happened. Someone can correct me, but literally the words were warrior ponytail, which how many times did I read in Farseer that Fitz had a warrior ponytail? And that's where I'm leading us to the whole point that Amber is the fool, which probably a lot of you who are watching this are well-seasoned Realm of the Elderling people, and you already knew that, but I didn't, because I'm not a visual reader, and I forgot, because it was over a year and a half ago, that at the end of Assassin's Quest, the Fool goes from being their pale complexion with blonde hair to a more tan complexion with blonde hair. I forgot that. So when we met Amber, who is portrayed as a different gender than the Fool, I think the Fool was gender neutral to male, I think was the portrayal, and here is Amber is portrayed as femme presenting the entire story, and also very tan. Like they describe how tan Amber is a lot. And so my brain never even connected the dots because I missed the point when the Fool transitioned, and I didn't really realize for most of the story that this took place after chronologically the events of Farseer, which it does. Like I think Ship of Magic is after Assassin's Quest chronologically in the timeline of this space. So the Fool could be there. So Amber is the Fool. They literally have lines playing off it. I'm positive Paragon looks like Fitz at the end. There are just so many things, down to the like item they find in the treasure trove that she keeps, because it's like of her people, who we still don't know what she is. She's not an elderling, because now we know elderlings are like dragonborn people, which is so cool, but we'll get to that. So that was a fantastic revelation, and I really like Amber. Like, I think my favorite part probably of this entire Realm of the Elderlings will be that the Fool is this integral part of the story the entire time. One thing that I am unsure of how I feel in this last portion of the story with Althea and Brashen is that, you know, Althea goes through rape. Like, it's a big deal. She can't really, you know, process that, and she doesn't know how to tell Brashen, and then it's even more complicated when Paragon takes in Kennet, and so Kennet's a part of the ship. You know, her abuser will always sort of be present, especially in the eyes of Paragon. Like, that's all so complicated. Like, so much therapy would need to be had to come to terms with this. And I think, as someone consuming a story, I like how Rob wrapped this up in terms of, like, it wasn't fixed overnight. There was, like, a whole season where she's very distant and really, like, having these nightmares, and she doesn't tell Brashen, and then eventually Paragon's like, you need to talk to me. I was hoping you'd come talk to me, but we need to talk, and I have this thing where I can't take away the memories of the event, but I can reduce the pain, and I'm going to do that because that pain wasn't Kennet's to give. It's this whole convoluted thing, and I didn't hate it, but it did feel a little bit like magic fixing trauma, a tiny bit. at least in my opinion, I think other people could see it differently. What I would have preferred, and I know would have made the book probably like 50 to 100 pages longer, is like kind of a slow therapy session. And that could have happened off page, but then you don't get that like optimistic fresh start of Althea and Brashen, which is satisfying. You know, you make it through these three books with this like tumultuous romance. So it is satisfying that they get to have this like optimistic start, you know, that isn't, you know, completely fresh. It still has the past, but it's better than where we left them before the winter season part of the book. So I'm of like two minds about that thing. It's probably the one thing maybe that's technically not perfect for me about this book, but I still don't hate it. And I still think a lot of the lack of agency that happens to female characters in this book and a lot of the assault and the harassment is handled with a lot of care and from different lenses. And for the most part, I really like how it's handled. So I think that's everything on that ship. And then Malta, who I have been loving Malta since Ship of Magic. I have had the unpopular opinion that Malta's great. Like, Malta was a brat. Malta was privileged. Malta did not understand how life worked. But Malta was fantastic to interact with. And then Madship happens, and some people are like, oh, I can see Malta stepping up to the plate. Malta's doing more. Again, still on Team Malta. I love Malta had to deal basically with a different version of herself for most of the story with the satrap. Is that how you say it? I still don't know how to say that dude's name. That little man-child person. But I loved that. I loved with her and Rain how they were like so unsure that the other would accept their physical appearance as they've been changed by the touch of the dragon. Oh, when they were having that reunion, I was just like, oh, just talk. Oh, you're both thinking the same thing. Oh my gosh, ah. And I love how perfect they are for each other. I love that she got to have that opulence and that they have this role in life. I love how much of a Bingtown traitor she became. Ugh, I just really loved the resourcefulness of this character, and it all felt earned. Like she still struggled. It's not like she did anything that didn't feel like was in the realm of her skills. Like, she's always been a character who's been manipulative and charismatic, and she's been living with traitors her whole life. Those are the tools she used to get over her circumstance. And it was still stressful, and there were still a lot of dangerous moments for her, but it was, I really liked that, and I really, again, loved that romance with Rain. And then Rain was with the dragon, which this dragon was awesome. The pride of this dragon race is top tier, and I'm excited to see them more, hopefully, in the Realm of the Elderlings. I'm assuming maybe Rainwilds, I'll get more of them, because there's, like, dragons on every book over there. But I loved how much we learned. I loved how powerless she felt and how, like, that brought her back into the plot to help fix parts of the plot. Like, she was the here comes the cavalry for so many parts of the book, but it always made complete sense. You got to have these epic dragon comes saves the day moment, but it made sense because, like, the dragon needed the humans to fix the thing so the serpents can go cocoon to become dragons, which I'm pretty sure we learned about in Madship, or I guessed about, and if I just guessed about it, I'm right. That's how that whole thing works. And, like, that whole thing was awesome. Like, that whole point of, like, the first thing you read in this series is from a serpent perspective, and you're like, what? And the last perspective you read is from a serpent perspective, becoming a dragon, like, in the in-between metamorphosis state. And it's just, it's going to be complicated. This world will never be the same. But the fact that a whole species has, like, survived potential, like, cataclysmic extinction, and how that interfered with the plot of our humans was fantastic. It was so good. And I loved even those moments that probably could be boring of, like, Bingtown discussing trade with the dragon and figuring things out. And Bingtown, you know how I've said Bingtown is a character for me? Bingtown has found its heart again, and I am so happy. I have been so stressed for Bingtown for so many books, and it's coming back. It's doing okay. So yeah, I love this series and this book. I did buy myself some pretty nice additions. Well, I don't know how nice they'll be. They looked like very good, like good to great edition, like condition hardback USA covers, because of the covers that exist, which there are four, I think, maybe five. There are three UK covers and there are two US covers, I think. My favorite are the US hardbacks, just because they lean into how colorful it is. And that's what I was able to find. I don't like the UK paperback binding, which is why I didn't want those. And you can only get them as mass market paperbacks in the United States, and like, nah. There's also, those covers aren't pretty enough. If they were pretty enough, I'd get them. So that's it for this one. Feel free to gush with me in the comments. I guess mark spoilers. I just hope no one clicks on this video and expects not to be spoiled. Like, this is just a spoiler chat of how awesome I found all of these moments. Like, so many moments just like, oh, will stick with me. It's so many climactic convergences. Like, as you can watch your characters come towards each other, it's just the most satisfying thing. So yeah, if you don't have anything to say and just want me to know you're here, leave a boat or an anchor or a dragon in the comments, but feel free to chat with me about it. No spoilers for the rest of the Realm of the Elderlings, please. And like if you liked it, subscribe if you want to, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.